Hello, everybody. So we will start with the scientific part, and as usual, we start with a keynote speaker. And sure, there's always a challenge. You know, the organizing committee exchanges emails and discusses who could be the keynote speaker, because this has to be a person well-known in the field with a lot of important contributions, but also a person who gives a good talk. And then four of us, behind the back of Susan, we came together and said, okay, Susan is the right person, and told her, you know, you have to start this meeting. Now, why did I vote for Susan? I can tell you, because she actually started the feast. She was in the lab of Lee Hartwell, and she actually worked with a gene, which is at the spindle probody. Well, she didn't do spindle probody work, but she used that, so the carbon, and there are actually several papers, 1981, 1983, on carbon and chiogamy. But Susan is also teaching yeast genetics to students, and I think this is actually quite important, because yeast genetics is great. Nowadays, people do a lot of CRISPR-Cas9, probably not even knowing what's behind it. And if you have the background of yeast genetic, I think you have a deep understanding. Can I have the first slide? And I think Susan is a tough teacher, because I found this test in the net, and basically, so using yeast genetics, she is addressing questions, for example, about meiosis in octopi, and you can see that, and if you are able actually to answer the question, you get 8 points out of 66, so I think it's quite tough. So you actually would think she works now with octopi, which is actually close. I mean, her model organism also swims. However, it's green and it has a flagellum. And this is actually where she did major contributions, because she used Chlamydomonas. And then the background of yeast genetics to analyze a lot of genes which are involved in ciliogenesis. And so I will stop here, because she will tell us the rest, what she has discovered over the years.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank the organizers for actually picking me before they made me part of the committee, so I didn't feel a conflict of interest there. As Elmar said, the organism that we work on is Chlamydomonas, and you can see it in this really beautiful electron micrograph. And these are cells that you can see stained, where the four basal bodies are actually being stained. I wanted to actually do a little bit of history. I went back and actually tried to find all of the abstract books from the meetings that have been going on. So this meeting is actually in its 20th year. So we're actually doing the 20th anniversary of the beginning of the Centrosomes and Spindle Pole Body meeting. It first started in Santa Cruz, and it was actually sponsored by the ASCB. And then we moved to Europe, and as you can see by this, we've actually gone through lots of interesting places and lots of interesting science. But if you think back to 1997, the tools that we had were really quite different. There were only yeast as a genome. Think of all the things you do using genomes now. It wasn't until 99 that the worm genome came online, and 2001 that the human genome came online. And the Chlamydomonas genome didn't appear until 2003. And so one of the major kinds of things that we actually use a lot nowadays didn't exist as we began to think about studying these amazing organelles in terms of microtubule organization. The kinds of microscopy that we can do now have dramatically changed since 1997 as well. And so things that we used to see just as blobs, we see amazing resolution now. And so the kinds of questions that we can ask actually have changed dramatically. And then we have lots of other tools that many people out here in the audience use. I mean, we can do proteomics, we can do proximity mapping, we have all kinds of ways to begin to actually know about the parts list for these organelles, and then begin to understand what they actually do for the cell. And so I'm going to give you, as an example, the things that we've actually done in Chlamydomonas. I'm going to give you a little bit of historical stuff, and then I'll hopefully take you to some of the new things that we're beginning to think about. Pretty amazing places that we've come and gone. I must have been very busy this year. This one is really torn up. So I think one of these meetings can't be intact without showing these beautiful pictures from Bovary. in which we can see stained with silver the chromosomes and the centrioles. Here's Chlamydomonas again. And the thing I want you to remember from this slide is that Chlamydomonas has two basal bodies, or centrioles, if you want to think about them that way. And in these cells, both of them, both the mother and the daughter, are able to build a cilium or a flagellum. And so that's one thing that's actually a little bit different about Chlamydomonas compared to what we see in mammalian cells or in metazoan. So here's Chlamydomonas. The feature that for clammy makes it easy for us to think about doing genetics and doing all kinds of different kinds of things is that they swim. So these two cilia or flagella at the anterior end of this organism that has a very large chloroplast can swim. It can actually respond, as you see it doing right now, to a light signal using the photopigment that's here in the eye. And so the cells, when you first saw them, were random. They were swimming all around. And when we gave them a green light, now they've just changed because the light's over here. These organisms can orient quite beautifully with respect to the light. And so this ability to swim is an important part of what we use as a phenotype as we begin to think about various things. So we have been looking at basal bodies in a lot of different ways. In large part, we have done amazing collaborations with Eileen O'Toole at the University of Colorado to do electron tomography. And again, let me just point out some of the unique features that we see in Chlamydomonas. So here are the two basal bodies made up with triplet microtubules. We transition into doublets, and there's this transition zone that appears in longitudinal section as this darkly staining H. If you look at that in cross-section, here actually in quick freeze deep etch, you see this incredible star structure. This is the stellate fibers that are actually in the transition zone region that make this nine-pointed stars that connect the doublet microtubules. You can also see here the cartwheel at the base comes out very beautifully, and then as we have transition fibers that are going up and attaching onto the plasma membrane. So here is an electron tomogram in which we've taken very thick sections and then taken multiple pictures, and using programs like CAT scan, we basically computationally sectioned it to about 1.5 nanometers, and it's now playing back to you as a movie, and so you can see these structures as we move back and forth. So we're going back down right now. We'll get down. There's the cartwheel. We're now moving back up, sort of the middle of the structure of the basal body, the transition fibers, the stellate star structure, and what will turn out to be the ciliary necklace. So clammy has actually been an organism that you may not have known. It's actually been studied for a long time. Back in 1926, these beautiful drawings of clammy as it goes through the cell cycle were made. So it has the two cilia or flagella. They basically begin to shorten. They lose these structures. The nucleus within the cell actually rotates. The chromosomes begin to condense. They make a spindle. They segregate their chromosomes. They make a cleavage furrow that starts from one side. And then they end up with two cells encased within a wall that was the original parent. And then they begin to build their next set of flagella. So we wanted to look at what happened during duplication events of the basal bodies in Chlamydomonas. And just as most of you think about, duplication is an event that you actually think about as belonging to S phase. In Chlamydomonas, that's not true. In Chlamydomonas, they're undergoing duplication actually during mitosis. And that's probably true for a large number of organisms. If you actually think about the diversity of things going on, it's not unique to Chlamydomonas. But the events that I'm going to tell you about actually occur in mitosis. So here we are in prophase, and let me get you oriented. Here's the mother and the daughter that you saw in longitudinal sections earlier. And then there are always two probasal bodies that go through the entire G1S phase of the cell cycle. So when you see staining with four dots, it's because we were actually seeing staining of the mother, the daughter, and these two probasal bodies. And then there are these very distinct microtubules, which in Chlamydomonas are called rootlet microtubules. They're four and two. They're very stable. They have a cetylated alpha tubulin on them. And they actually are going to turn out to be involved in cleavage. So in prophase, what we begin to see first is that The two probasal bodies actually begin and elongate. We then have them reorient, so they're no longer sitting at angles with each other. They become almost parallel to one another. And then an old and a new one will move to one pole, an old and new will move to the other pole, and you'll now have them positioned on the two sides of the nucleus. They also begin to assemble all of these cytoplasmic microtubules shown here in yellow. The next thing that happens actually happens during metaphase, and it actually is the beginning of the formation of a new basal body that will become the probasal bodies of the next cycle. And what we actually see both here by longitudinal sections in this structure here and in cross-section here is that there's a ring, a cartwheel, that actually begins to form. And because of these rootlet microtubules, we actually know which triplet microtubules are which. They all have very distinct features. They are associated with different structures, with different centron structures, and other striated fibers in the cell. And in Chlamydomonas, the cartwheel always forms, and always is 14 reconstructed cells, on triplets 7 and 8. And so we are really intrigued, and we would love to know what sits on triplets 7 and 8. What might be there to think about licensing the formation and of the new probasal body? I like this picture that comes from Eric Ning's lab, because when you look at PLK4, you also see that which will begin to be the formation of the new centriole that's going to happen in mammalian cells, happens actually from these images on one or two of the triplets. And so I don't think this is a unique feature to Chlamydomonas. It just turns out that because of all the other fibers that are there, we actually can identify the triplets that are there, and we would love to know what's going on. And we've been trying a number of different ways, but I don't have a nice result to tell you right now. So here's the metaphase spindle. We've reconstructed it both with the central microtubules as well as the kinetochore microtubules. And the thing I want you to notice is that these basal bodies, which are now here, or centrioles, actually sit off of the spindle. We have two that are the mother and the daughter that have nice triplet microtubules, and the two probasal bodies, which are going to get formed, and they are now singlet microtubules. Okay? The next thing we observed, which actually happens during telophase of mitosis, is that we can actually watch as the doublets and triplets begin to form. And the interesting thing, as you can see from these images, is that the doublets and triplets are forming from the distal end of the microtubule, the end of the microtubule that we think of as the minus end. And so much as actually has been seen from mammalian cells, where it seems like doublets and triplets might actually form in the middle of the structures, it looks like these things undergo a very different mechanism for being able to be assembled, and that it actually moves from minus to plus. So basal body duplication during mitosis in clammy involves first building elongating the probasal bodies, reorienting them, assembling a lot of microtubules, moving them apart to the poles of the spindle, and then we begin to see the formation of the cartwheel and that these doublet microtubules assemble from the minus end. So we think that there are lots of really unique features that we can get from using clammy by actually moving through and looking at these events as they happen in synchronized cells. So when the Chlamydomonas genome became available, it gave us a real tool to begin to see if we could find proteins that were going to be involved in building these structures. And so we did a comparative genomics experiment, taking advantage of the fact that much of the eukaryotic tree build basal bodies, centrioles, cilia, and flagella, with a few exceptions, in particular green plants. And so what we did, and I'm showing you in a sort of different way, is that we looked at how similar the Chlamydomonas gene was to the genes in humans and in the plant Arabidopsis, which don't build centrioles or cilia. And genes that are above the horizontal here are genes which have turned out to be specific for cilia and centrioles. Genes down here are genes that are actually specific to green plants, things that do photosynthesis. And this actually gave us the beginning of a very nice catalog of potential things that might be involved in building these structures. This is just a slightly different way to look at that, in which we looked at 40 organisms, and this is an IFT protein involved in building the cilia. And you can see, compared to Chlamydomonas, everything is pretty similar. And then as once you hit to things that don't have cilia or centrioles, the number drops off incredibly. And so you can use this then to make a second kind of parts list for genes that are involved in these organelles. So we really like genetics, as you saw from Elmar's slide. The first mutation that actually was available in Chlamydomonas, and I think it may have been the first mutation in any organism that ended up affecting basal bodies, was a gene that Ursula Goodenough isolated called BALD2. BALD because it's missing its cilia and flagella. And shown here, Ursula always loves great names. And when Ursula actually looked at it by electron microscopy, she saw that instead of having triplets, that some of the cells had singlet microtubules, and some of the cells actually had no noticeable structures that were present. In addition, centrin, unlike in other organisms, actually forms fibers that connect the basal bodies to the nucleus. Those fibers were disrupted. The rootlet microtubules that I told you about, as you can see from these immunofluorescence pictures, normally make this nice cross-shaped things using antibodies to acetylated alpha tubulin, become completely disorganized. And when that happens, the cleavage furrow actually becomes randomly placed. So instead of making a cleavage furrow like this, you can see that this cell actually made it parallel to the spell. So you end up getting cells that are anucleate, binucleate, and at least some of them are happy enough that they survive. And so this mutant ended up having a variety of interesting phenotypes. We now know that it also has a meiotic phenotype, that homozygous for BALD2 is unable to complete successfully meiosis. And as I'll tell you more about, the microtubules in these cells seem to be hyperstabilized. And so that really was our first mutant. Turns out, we then wanted to try to find additional mutants that would be involved in this pathway for building these structures. And the mutants that we pulled out, BALD2, which we've shortened to its official three-letter name, is epsilon tubulin. Masafumi Hirani isolated BALD 10 and 12, which are CEP-135 and SAS-6. UNI-2, that Carolyn Siflow and I both isolated independently, is CEP-120. UNI-3 is delta tubulin. VFLs are things that actually make too many, end up having too many basal bodies. And I'll come back to these two that are in Katahnin. And one of the things that we noticed about all of these mutants that all have various defects in assembling a basal body is that they turned out to be super sensitive to the action of Taxol. So Taxol, as most of you know, is a microtubule drug that binds to beta tubulin and stabilizes the microtubules. And what I mean by supersensitivity is that Chlamydomonas is sensitive to Taxol at one particular concentration, wild-type cells, but all of these mutants are sensitive to Taxol that's about threefold lower than the wild-type level of sensitivity, and therefore we refer to them as supersensitive. And all of these guys are sensitive, including the genes in Katahnin. And so somehow, having defects in the basal bodies have changed the stability of the microtubules in the cell. So we decided a few years ago to actually go back, because this was a fairly small list. We were sort of surprised how few we actually had. And so we set out to do a new screen. We first looked for things that were non-swimming, and so we simply put them into liquid medium. Things that can't swim fall to the bottom, so that's a really easy thing to do. We then tested for Taxol supersensitivity, and we kept those that were sensitive. We then looked for the localization of either UNI-2, which is shown here as these four dots, present on both the mother, the daughter, and the probasal bodies, or for NPHP4, a protein that's out in the transition zone. Then we showed that they co-segregated, and then we did whole genome sequencing on them. So the first one that we got out is a gene that all of you in this audience, I assume, know. It's SAS4. So it turns out it's a flagellate. It's taxol supersensitive. The mutant that we actually got was a stop codon relatively early. It can't localize CEP120. And all of these phenotypes segregate, and the mutation segregates in 25 tetrads. We also isolated revertants, and we know that they actually now change and restore the phenotype as well. This is a gene you guys know a lot about. It was first found in worms by many people in this audience. It rests in the cell division. The SAS4 homolog in humans is CPAP and is involved with microcephaly and dwarfism. And as Catherine Anderson's lab first showed, that null mutants actually have arrested development and death, and that can be suppressed by mutants in P53. And so we wanted to then ask, what else can we learn about the gene in Chlamydomonas? So the first thing we did is we turned back to looking at by electron tomography with Eileen O'Toole. And the thing that we saw is that it built partial doublets, although usually when it built them, they were actually a fairly normal length. And we saw anywhere from 3 to 8 doublet microtubules, never triplets. The proximal end is always spread out, and we never see the cartwheel in these strains. So it's not present. It has cytokinesis defects, like many of the basal body mutants in Chlamydomonas. And it has trouble organizing its rootlet microtubules as well. Lee Hartwell, thank you, Elmar, for introducing Lee. We wanted to know whether there were defects beyond just the problems with cleavage furrows. We wanted to know whether there were actually potentially spindle assembly defects in these cells. And so we looked by microscopy. Things looked fairly well. These are just an array of pictures to show you what's going on. And then we turned to the idea that maybe we could take advantage of checkpoints that Lee Hartwell was doing as I was leaving the lab as a graduate student. And then Rong Lee and Andrew Murray and the Hoyt lab went on to find spindle assembly checkpoint genes by a screen in which if you treat with Benamil, they sort of die off. But if you treat with Benamil in the presence of a spindle assembly checkpoint, they actually die. And so we wanted to actually ask whether the mutants in Chlamydomonas, these basal body mutants, actually have a defect in spindle assembly. And so what we did is that Chlamy has a new resource. It's called the CLIP collection. It's a set of about 75,000 insertional mutants from the Jonicus lab. We ended up getting 2 alleles of BUB1 and 2 alleles of MAD2. We verified they were there. You can see they have beautiful viability. They give us nice 4 viable progeny. And so we went on then to actually do tetrads. And so we wanted to then ask, if we made the double mutant, either BUB1 or MAD2, together with SAS4, what happened? And so we dissected out tetrads. If they're parental and they're all parental genotypes, they all should live. In here, we wanted to know whether the double mutant dies or is slow growing, and whether the single double in a tetratype is actually viable or not. And the answer is that in 34 tetrads, if you carry a spindle assembly checkpoint, these cells die coming out of meiosis. So we feel very confident saying that although we don't see really gross defects in terms of building a spindle, the cells actually seem to have a defect, and we can basically uncover it by making a synthetic situation in which we can actually see inviability. Okay, so I told you that the other two genes that have come out, which do not have a basal body phenotype, their basal bodies, and we've looked carefully at them, appear completely normal, are the two proteins catenin P80 and P60. They're a heterodimer that's involved in microtubule severing. They turn out to both be very sensitive to the action of taxol. And so we looked, and we can see catenin living at the poles of the spindle, and that in the bald mutant, as well as all of our other mutants that we've looked, catenin no longer localizes to the poles of the spindle. And so we think that one possible mechanism for getting out this hyperstability, this taxol supersensitivity for these cells, is that it may be that the basal bodies are actually important for the recruiting of catenin to the poles. And I give you this paper that came out of just a few months ago that suggests that ASP, abnormal spindle protein, might actually also be interact with catenin, and so that potentially these might actually be now overlapping in terms of if we begin to think about basal bodies from clammy recruiting catenin, it looks like it potentially that they may actually be recruited in Drosophila as well. So we actually have three ASP mutants now in clammy, and we hopefully will see what they do in terms of affecting microtubule stability and their action. Okay, so we had isolated a lot of mutants. We went back. And the next mutant that I want to tell you about turns out to be a mutant in a clammy gene that's called CNK10. CNK10 falls by phylogeny into the cluster that contains NEC1, NEC3, and NEC5. I'm going to refer to it as NEC1, but we cannot actually distinguish that right now. The NECs have turned out, also as NIMA-like kinases, to be involved in lots of different events in the cell, in mitosis, in ciliogenesis, in DNA damage repair, in acetylation. And the ones in Chlamydomonas also have phenotypes that have a lot to do with how you build your cilia and flagella, either by severing, they can affect flagellar length, and they seem to have a role in this very conserved structure. NEC1 mutants are associated in mice with PKD, with polycystic kidney disease, with the short rib polydactyly phenotype, a disease that's actually and seems to involve a lot of genes involved in IFT and interflagellar transport, and in oral facial digital syndrome, again, genes that may actually affect the transition zone of the ciliary complex. So we have three different alleles. All of the alleles fall in their insertions, they fall into introns, and all of them make cells very sensitive to the action of Taxol. They actually make the cells get very large. The cells are now about probably 5 to 10 times larger than a wild type cell. And it's true for all of the different alleles that we have. We have a wild type construct that can rescue the phenotype of the CNK10-2, which is here, and CNK10-3. But it does not rescue the phenotypes of 10-1. We went in to ask whether these were null alleles, and so we've done a lot of RNA-seq, and we're beginning to do nanopore sequencing to actually verify a lot of these things. We find that the message level is down in all of them, and that in all of these mutants, they have missplicing that ends up resulting in deletions of various parts of the protein. This one, we think, is actually a dominant, because since we cannot rescue it by a transgene, and we can't rescue it in a diploid cell either. We wanted to also then take a different way to look and ask what was happening to the microtubules with respect to Taxol supersensitivity. And we went back to an assay that we did a long, long time ago that was suggested to us by Dick McIntosh. And that is, we stained cells with antibody to alpha tubulin in the presence of fixative, or we stained the same cells with the same antibody such that they were actually first washed with PBS and then fixed. And so the cytoplasmic microtubules in clammy are very sensitive to that action, much like many of you might treat cells with nicotizol in cold. Turns out all we have to do is treat them with PBS and then fix them. And all the microtubules basically depolymerize, except for these four beautiful ones, which are the rootlet microtubules that I showed you previously that are very stable. And so here in green now, instead of in black and white, are wild-type, which you can see lots of microtubules. You then wash them, the rootlets remain behind. But as an example here, CNK2 microtubules, and then with washing, those microtubules remain. So again, another example that the microtubules seem to have a different property than what we see in wild-type cells. So we've quantitated that. And in wild type, we have two different wild type strains that we use, so we've used both of them. But in CNK10, the number of cells that have more than the four rootlet microtubules dramatically increases in each of the mutants. And in fact, it's massively increased when we actually look at the mutant plus the transgene, and we don't quite understand that. We think, in fact, that it's probably actually a poison and is actually having a greater effect than it does on its own. We also wanted to see if we could find suppressors of these phenotypes, because now we have a very easy phenotype. They arrest on taxol medium. We simply mutagenized and selected for suppressors that would come back out. And we ended up getting mutations in alpha tubulin that suppress the taxol supersensitivity. And that turns out to be a mutant that actually causes the microtubules to be incredibly unstable, and they actually are hardly there before PBS. They're gone after PBS, and that mutant is incredibly, goes down to basically being very similar to the wild type strain. And the Katahnin mutant here, just to show you, which was taxol supersensitive, also has hyperstabilized microtubules. What's the target of these things? Well, we don't know. We're actually in the middle of looking at Katahnin. It definitely undergoes phosphorylation events. We don't yet have data. We've been trying to actually get that out and do proteomics on it to get that out. But we think that this one possible place that these things might be acting. But there are probably lots of others, because the necks have many potential targets, and we're hoping that we'll be able to answer this in some amount of time. I'm going to just give you a few hints here at the end of other things that we've pulled out of our screen. And so we know very little about these, but I just want to give you a range of the kinds of things that come out of this screen so that you can actually see what's going on. So this is male germ cell-associated kinase-like. It's a lysine to methionine change here in this incredibly conserved region. So this is a blast of the Chlamydomonas gene with respect to the human gene. This gene has been implicated in retinitis pigmentosa. It's been implicated in cilia length control. And when we looked at it by electron tomography, it turns out it doesn't have a basal body defect. So the cartwheel seems fine, the triplets seem fine, all of the striated fibers that link these structures together seem fine, transition fiber is fine, the transition zone is fine. It seems just unable to extend beyond a slightly bulbous membrane projection. And so we're really intrigued by this one now, because it really does suggest that it's actually going to be an important gene for actually initiating the growth of cilia or the maintenance of cilia. These are two more mutants that we pulled out. Again, they have very stabilized microtubules for the most part. This gene is TMM45B. There's nothing I can find except potential relationships to cancer and overexpression. And this is an FBAR protein, of which there are many, and I could not tell you which is the homolog. This actually has a very strong cytokinesis phenotype. And you can see that this cell actually has at least 6 cilia or flagella. There are cells that have 8 to 10 cilia or flagella, and so we're really intrigued by what it might actually be doing. So we've made it through 20 years of centrosome and spindle pole body meetings, and I think that what I wanted to do is sort of finish by talking briefly about where we're going to go, and I think we'll hear that over the course of the next 3 days, about where the field is going and what everybody is actually beginning to find. But at least from what we've been thinking a lot about, we have really kind of questions that we would love to know more about. So I don't know if I will be here at the 40-year of this meeting or not, but we're really intrigued by trying to find out what specifies this site. We like to think about it as a potential site for licensing, that this might be a place, if you actually had too many of them, that you would build too many procentrioles, that maybe if you look in a deuterosome, that this might actually change as well. We'd like to know what kind of proteins you need to start to build the doublets and the triplets. There are lots of possibilities out there, and we'd like to know how it moves from the minus to the plus end, as opposed to plus to minus. We'd like to know what the targets of NEC1 is. We'd like to know what the target of the MAC, the male germ cell proteins are, and what they're doing. We didn't talk very much about daughters and mothers, an issue that really was one of the reasons I got into thinking about centrosomes, is how do you begin to think about what makes a mother and a daughter beyond just adding on distal and subdistal appendages? What are the kinds of things that go on? And in Chlamydomonas, delta tubulin ends up having a very specific phenotype that suggests that it actually allows for a transition between mothers and daughters. And then we still know very few of these genes in terms of what they are as null alleles, what they can do. I'm really intrigued by the fact that these genes almost all seem to play a role in meiosis, that when we make them homozygous, they actually make spores, but the spores all die. And so we would love to know how that's doing. And then again, we would like to know how they're actually impacting spindle assembly. I have, for a long time, had thought our mutants didn't have any role in spindle assembly, that they were really important for building the cilia and the flagella, that they have impacted cleavage furrow. And so I'm really intrigued by the fact that our mutants turn out to die when we put assembly checkpoint mutants together with them, suggesting that they actually do have mild effects that we don't see on their own, but as synthetics, we can actually generate out this synthetic lethal phenotype. So let me just thank the people who did a bunch of this work. Hua-Wen Lin has been my longtime postdoc and now senior scientist in the lab. Su Yang and I actually did all the screens for new mutants, and she was a technician. Jessica started the work on taxol sensitivity, and Eileen is our longtime collaborator for looking at the electron microscopy. And again, thank you.
Thank you very much for this fantastic talk. Are there any questions, Pierre?
Yeah, I was wondering whether the synthetic lethality that you showed between SAS4 and the spindle assembly checkpoint mutants, is that specific to the meiotic cell cycle? And have you explored that with inhibitors, for instance?
We have tried a number of inhibitors in clammy, and they haven't had any effect. And I think the problem is getting them into the cells. So right now, we are attempting to make temperature-sensitive mutants in the spindly assembly checkpoints so that we can actually try to do that experiment. Because right now, the phenotype is really a meiotic phenotype, which might agree with the fact that these things have a very strong meiotic phenotype, but we don't know the answer yet.
I'm curious what you might think the mechanism of the taxol supersensitivity is. What of your mutants? Are they their cell division?
So we think at least part of the phenotype comes through the action of catenin. We know that if we make double mutants between catenin and a variety of the mutants, they actually are more taxol sensitive and they grow more slowly, so they have greater defects in mitotic cell cycles. I think there's good evidence that catenin, and certainly in worms, that catenin has an important role in meiosis, although it has a much less effect in mitotic spindles. And so that's at least one place where we think it's doing, where you actually need catenin to basically trim microtubules during a spindle. We've looked for other synthetic phenotypes, and we haven't found any yet.
Can you please use the microphone, Tim, so that other people also can hear you?
Maybe we could have people introduce themselves, too, since there are new people at the meeting as well, and it would be good for people to know.
That would be nice. Tim Stearns, Stanford University. Nice to see you all. The growth of the triplet or doublet microtubules from the distal end of the centriole is very interesting because, as you say, we think that that happens either from the proximal end or maybe from the middle in some way in mammalian cells. But one of the features of mammalian centrioles, and I think it's true of clammy too, is that there's a transition from triplets to doublets as you get near the distal end of the centriole. So if you're starting to grow from that distal end, how is that transition from doublets to triplets established? Just visual, at least, do you know? Have you seen that?
So most of the cells that we've looked at haven't yet built a transition zone. So the building of the doublet, the triplets, for the basal body happens before the transition zone happens. And so I'm assuming the transition zone grows from plus to minus.
Okay.
But we don't, we have very few images of that actually to know. So they haven't, these are not associated with a transition zone when we're looking at them at this point.
And then does it look like the triplets actually grow as triplets then? You make both the B and the C tubules?
All the images we have look like they always have doublets. It's not that it builds doublets and then the triplet. It actually builds the B and the C at the same time.
Yes, please use the microphone.
So can you reinterpret then the BALD2 and the UNI2 phenotypes in thinking about that they grow from the doublets and triplets grow from the distal end? Have you thought about reinterpreting or looking more at BALD2 and UNI2 since they lack either triplets or doublets to see whether or not the defect really is not in promoting the growth of the doublets and triplets, but rather in having a region where those things grow from?
So Tim's paper in mammalian cells has made us think about doing that. And I'm trying to convince Eileen that we would like to try to do that experiment. So we haven't done that yet.
But any of the old EMs like shed light on that? Or
there, I mean, the problem is that most of the EM that's in clammy, it spends most of its life in G1. And so we have to actually go in and specifically synchronize the cells in order that we can actually look in mitosis. And so we haven't gone back to do that with the delta and epsilon mutants yet. I mean, we would love to actually then throw in the zeta mutant as well to see how that actually impacts it, because the delta is clearly doublets only, which I didn't tell you very much about, but it's only doublets. And so we would love to know whether there's some role there at the initiation point to actually begin to grow them down toward the plus end. But we haven't done that yet.
Okay, so thank you very much again, Susan, for this wonderful talk.